Welcome again. So in this class we will go for some more problems on two-dimensional heat conduction. So first we will consider a problem on two-dimensional heat conduction in a fin. So earlier we already solved problems on heat conduction in a fin considering one-dimensional temperature variation, where the temperature varies from the tip of the fin to the base of the fin, or you can say in the reverse manner, temperature from the base of the fin to the tip of the fin. So in this case you assumed that temperature is not varying in the other two directions, and here we will consider a case where you will take temperature is varying along the two dimensions, along the third dimension, that is along the thickness of the fin, temperature remains almost constant, assuming that the dimension of this fin along its thickness is small compared to the other two dimensions. Suppose you have a surface which is at a relatively higher temperature. So to this surface we will attach one extended surface, let us say of this shape as shown here in this diagram. Let us say thickness of this fin is delta, width of this fin is 2L. So here if you closely observe, there exists an symmetry on this diagram. So the symmetry will be about the width of this fin. So you can take L on one side and L on the other side. So you can have one line passing through this horizontal surface. If you look from the top of this diagram, that will divide this area into two parts. So here for the purpose of analysis, we will consider one small elemental volume in this space, for which the area will be delta x by delta y as shown here. And on this small elemental volume we will go for the energy balance, and this energy balance will help us to find the governing differential equation for this particular problem. So here this shows the top view of this three-dimensional geometry. So here in this case we are considering the temperature is not varying along its thickness delta, because this delta is small compared to the other two dimensions. So this is the line of symmetry shown here by this dotted line. So half of this part will be the analysis we will carry out here. So on this base the temperature is equals to the temperature of this hot surface, let it equals to T naught. Then on the surface at this tip, here we consider temperature equal to temperature of the ambient fluid, because here we consider this length of this fin is very high. So that means x extends from 0 at the base to infinity at the tip of this fin. So that means the fin extends from 0 to infinity. Then other two edges also the temperature is equal to temperature of the ambient fluid. That means here we consider the convective heat transfer coefficient is very high. So here we will consider half of this diagram as the analysis. So here you consider this elemental volume on which you will go for the energy balance. So from this left face you are getting heat entering into this volume by means of conduction, let it be Qx, that is heat conduction in the x direction. Then heat leaving to this from this volume on the opposite face, that is equal to Qx plus delta x, where delta x is the dimension along the x direction. Similarly in the y direction, heat enters into this volume by means of conduction, that is Q y, and heat leaves from this volume by means of conduction equals to Q y plus delta y, where delta y is the dimension in the y direction. Then you will have two more surface, one is the top surface and another one is the bottom surface, from which heat transfer takes place by means of convection to the ambient fluid. So let we denote this total heat that is going from these two surfaces by means of convection, let it be Qc. So you go for the energy balance, total energy in is equals to total energy out. So here in this case energy in is Qx and Qy, so that is on the left side of this equation. Then energy out are Qy plus delta y, Qx plus delta x and Qc, that is convective heat transfer. So now you can rewrite the expression for Qx plus delta x, which you can write as dou by dou x of Qx into delta x. Then expression for Qy, that will become sorry, expression for qy plus delta y, that becomes qy plus dou y of qy into delta y. Then expression for this convective heat transfer, that is equals to simple expression h a into delta t. So here h is the convective heat transfer coefficient, a is the surface area from which heat transfer takes place, and delta t is the temperature difference that drives this heat transfer. So that is temperature of the surface minus temperature of the ambient fluid, so T minus T infinity. So here you will see there is a Qx on the left hand face, there is a Qx on the right side of this equation, so they will cancel each other. Similarly, there is a Qy on the left hand side, there is a Qy on the right hand side, so they will also cancel. So finally, what remains, that you can rewrite. So what remains is dou y dou x of Qx into delta x plus dou y dou y of Qy into delta y plus h a delta t equals to 0. So now this Qx you can rewrite using the basic heat conduction, that becomes minus k into a into dt by dx. Similarly, this Qy becomes minus k into a into dt by dy. So here this A I represented as AC, that means area of cross section through which heat transfer by means of conduction takes place. But please remember, this AC and this AC, they are not exactly same, because this is the area through which heat transfer takes place in the x direction, and this is the area through which heat transfer takes place by means of conduction, but this is in the x direction, this is in the y direction. So they are different values because their dimensions are different here. So this area of cross section through which heat transfer takes place in the x direction will be equals to delta y multiplied by delta. Similarly, for this case, this will become delta x into delta. So that you can rewrite again here. So here I wrote it, the value of area of cross section here and this area of cross section here. Then this surface area from which heat transfer takes place, this is from the top face and from the bottom face. So one face area is delta x into delta y. So total will be 2 into delta x into delta y. So now you further simplify this and you can rewrite this expression as dou square t by dou x square plus dou square t by dou y square minus 2 h by k delta into t minus t infinity equals to 0. So this is the governing differential equation for this two dimensional heat conduction from this fin. So this will require in total 4 number of boundary conditions, 2 along the x direction, 2 along the y direction. So if you closely observe, this governing differential equation is not homogeneous. So then we will rewrite the 4 boundary conditions. So one will be at x is equals to 0, second one is at x is equals to infinity, third one is at y equals to 0, fourth one is at y is equals to L. So at x is equals to 0, t is equals to t naught. Second boundary condition is x is equals to infinity, again t is equals to t infinity. Third boundary condition along this dotted line, that is y equals to 0, its dt by dy will be equals to 0. Then fourth one, y is equals to L, that is here again t is equals to t infinity. So if you closely observe these boundary conditions, other than this third boundary condition, the remaining 3 are not homogeneous. But for solving the problem, we require at least 3 boundary conditions should be homogeneous along with the governing differential equation. That means we need to do something so that we will be able to convert this non-homogeneous governing differential equation and the boundary conditions into homogeneous form. So for which you can use a simple transformation, theta equals to t minus t infinity. So please remember, here theta is not dimensionless, here it is in dimension form only. So earlier in many occasions we use the symbol theta to represent dimensionless temperature, but here it is not dimensionless, it is dimension itself, okay. But this is a transformation which will help us to convert this non-homogeneous equations into homogeneous form. Then you take this 2 h by k delta, that is equals to m square. So using this simple transformation, you rewrite these 5 equations, that is this governing differential equation and these 4 boundary conditions. So first, this governing differential equation, this t will be replaced by theta. So you will get dou square theta by dou x square plus dou square theta by dou y square minus, this becomes m square into t minus t infinity equals to theta equals to 0. Then we will rewrite these 4 boundary conditions. So using this transformation, first equation will become at x is equals to 0, theta will be equals to t 0 minus t infinity, that you can write as theta 0. Then second equation becomes at x is equals to infinity, theta equals to 0. Then third equation will be y equals to 0 dt by dy 0, this becomes d theta by dy equals to 0. Then fourth equation at y equals to l, this theta becomes 0. So now if you closely observe these five equations, so here the second, third and fourth, these three boundary conditions are now homogeneous. Earlier only boundary condition 3 was only homogeneous. So we are able to make two more boundary conditions, that is boundary condition 2 and boundary condition 4 as homogeneous, including the governing differential equation. So now we can solve this equation very easily. So here this is the governing differential equation I have written here. So for the purpose of solution, we need to take the help of the method of separation of variables, where you consider the solution theta, which is function of x and y, as the product of two separate functions x and y, that is capital X and y, where capital X is function of x only and capital Y is function of y only. So they represent the temperature itself, not dimensions. Okay. So now using this product solution theta equal to x dot y, you rewrite the governing differential equation. So you put this here and you rewrite this equation. So that will tell you y into dou square capital X by dou x square plus capital X into dou square y by dou y square minus m square x y equals to 0. So now you can divide the whole expression by x y. So you will get, so when you divide here first term by x y, you will get 1 by x dou square x by dou x square minus m square, this x y will cancel. Then what remains, this term you take to the other side, that will be equals to, here it is plus, so on the other side this becomes minus, so you will get minus 1 by y into dou square y by dou y square. So why we wrote it like this, because you see here things on the left hand side are purely function of x and things on the right hand side are purely function of y. So let it be equals to some constant. So that constant, let's suppose you write down, it is plus or minus lambda square. So here we will consider the plus sign, plus lambda square. So the concept have been explained to you earlier, how to select the proper sign, whether it should be plus or minus. So here we will consider plus lambda square. Then you take the term on the left hand side along with this plus lambda square, try to form one equation. Then you take the term on the right hand side, that is this term along with this lambda square, you form another equation. So that you will get two separate equations and they will be purely function of x and y respectively. So when you take 1 by x dou square x by dou x square minus m square equals to plus lambda square, further simplify, you will get d square x by dx square minus m square plus lambda square whole into x. So you see why I wrote it d, because now this is purely function of x. Similarly, from second part you will get d square y by dy square plus lambda square y equals to 0, because there is a negative sign, this comes to the other side, becomes positive. So you get two separate equations, and for this case you can find out the general solution, and for this case also you can find out the general solution. Then theta is function of multiplication of x and y, so you multiply these two general solutions, that will give you the general solution for theta. So this is the general solution for x, that is c1 into e to the power minus square root of lambda square plus m square into x plus c2 into e to the power minus into square root of lambda square plus m square into x. Then from here general solution for y, you will get c1 cos lambda y plus c3 cos lambda y plus c4 sin lambda y, and theta you will get product of x and y. Okay. So you can take this x and y separately, then you multiply x and y, that will tell you the value of the theta, which is function of x and y again. So I wrote the expression for theta here by multiplying these two expressions. Now what we will do is we will go for finding the value of C1, C2, C3, C4, these are the four unknowns. So, if you are able to get the values of these unknowns, that will give you the expression for theta, which is function of x and y. And theta is nothing but t minus t infinity. So, once you get theta, then you can get t, that will be equal to theta plus t infinity. So, to get this value of C1, C2, C3, C4, you need to take the help of these four boundary conditions. So, first you will take boundary condition number 3, using this boundary condition 3, using this in this expression, and when you simplify, that will give you the value of the constant C4, which comes out to be equals to 0. That means here in this expression, this C4 0, that means this fourth term will become 0. So, what remains here will be this term multiplied by C3 cos lambda y. So, that is equals to theta. So, theta equals to C1 e to the power minus square root of lambda square plus m square into x plus C2 e to the power square root of lambda square plus m square into x whole into C3 cos lambda y. This is the expression for theta. Then again we will use another boundary condition, that is boundary condition number 4, which tells at y equals to L theta equals to 0. So, wherever you see in this expression, you take y equals to L theta equals to 0. So, the left hand side becomes 0, this will be as it is, and here you are having a y, so that you write as cos lambda L, because y becomes L here. So, from here you will see C3 into cos lambda L equals to 0. That means there are two options, either C3 is 0 or cos lambda L is 0. So, first we will take C3 0. So, if C3 becomes 0, that means everything becomes 0. So, theta will 0. So, that is why C3 0 is not possible. So, the other alternative is cos lambda L should be equals to 0. So, from here you will get cos of 2n plus 1 into pi by 2 equals to 0, because cos lambda L is 0. This is true for different values of n. So, what are the values of n? This n can be 0, 1, 2, 3, like this, any value of n, this is true. So, from here you will get this lambda n equals to 2n plus 1 into pi by 2 L. So, now we can take this expression for theta, and this lambda needs to be replaced by lambda n, whose expression is function of n, and n this n value is true for different values, that is 0, 1, 2, 3, like this. So, you can rewrite the expression for theta again here. So, you rewrite this lambda as lambda n everywhere. So, still you have two more unknowns, C1 and C2, then we need to find their values using the remaining two boundary conditions. So, next we will use the boundary condition number 2, which says at x is equals to infinity, theta equals to 0. So, when you apply this boundary condition, you will get the value of C2 will be equals to 0, because here you see when you put x is equals to infinity, so you get C1 e to the power minus infinity plus C2 e to the power infinity. So, this will becomes e to the power minus infinity is 1 by e to the power infinity. Okay. So, that is why this C2 should be equals to 0, 1 by infinity is 0, that is why this will be 0, this becomes infinity, but left hand side it is 0, that is why infinity should be multiplied by 0. So, then only you will get 0 on the right hand side, that is why C2 equals to 0. Then you rewrite this expression again by taking this C2 equals to 0. So, what remains here is theta is equals to C1 e to the power minus square root of lambda square plus m square x into C3 cos lambda n y. So, they are having product of two unknowns, C1 and C3, so that you can combine them, it will form again another unknown. Let us say you rewrite as Cn, and what remains here is the remaining thing you rewrite exactly. So, you get theta equal to Cn into this term. So, now we will apply the principle of superposition, then you will take the help of this the final boundary condition, that is boundary condition number 1. To get the ultimate solution. So, when you apply this principle of superposition, you can write the expression for theta, that becomes sigma n equals to 0 to infinity Cn e to the power minus square root of lambda n square plus m square into x into cos lambda n y. All these are lambda n's. So, then we will use the final boundary condition, that is boundary condition number 1, which says x is equals to 0. Theta equals to theta 0. So, you apply here So theta becomes theta 0, and wherever you see x, that becomes 0. So here you are having x, so it becomes e to the power 0, e to the power 0 is 1 only. So what remains here, right hand side will be sigma n is equal to 0 to infinity c n into cos lambda n y. So from here you can get the value of c n. This theory already explained to you earlier. This will tell you that is equal to fraction of 2 integration. So at the top you will get integration of theta 0 cos lambda n y dy with limit 0 to l. At the bottom you will get the integration cos square lambda n y into dy with limit 0 to l. So here you can evaluate this integration at the lower, and which comes out to be equals to l by 2, and this is 1 by l by 2 becomes 2 by l into the integration at the top, that is integration of 0 to l theta 0 cos lambda n y into dy. So that is the expression for c n. This theta 0 is a constant that can be taken outside this integration. So you will get 2 theta 0 by l into integration of cos lambda n y dy with limit 0 to l. Okay, so I am rewriting it here. Then now you can go for simplifying this integration by integrating this cos lambda n y dy and place the limit 0 to l. So you will get the value on solving this integration that comes out to be 4 theta 0 by pi into minus 1 to the power n by 2 n plus 1. So this is the expression for c n, and this expression for c n you can use it here, then you can find the expression for theta, that is the temperature profile. So you will get this theta will become 4 theta 0 by pi. So the remaining terms are, these are function of n, that is why this remaining terms will remain inside this sigma, and this term can be taken outside the sigma because it is a constant. So what remains inside will be sigma n equals to 0 to infinity minus 1 to the power n by 2 n plus 1 into the remaining two terms, that is cos lambda n y into e to the power minus square root of lambda n square plus m square x, where this lambda n equals to 2 n plus 1 into pi by 2 l. This already we wrote it earlier. Next we will consider another problem, that is two dimensional heat conduction in a geometry. So this problem will be slightly similar to the previous one only. So here let us say you consider you have a domain and two dimensional geometry where temperature T is function of x and y having constant thermal conductivity K. Let us say on this left face the temperature T is given as function of y, that is it is varying along the y direction, and this function in a particular problem will be given to you or it will be known to you. Then let us say on the right face the temperature T is some constant value, that is equal to T infinity, and the from the remaining two faces the heat transfer from the surfaces are by means of convection, for which the ambient fluid temperature are T infinity having heat transfer coefficient, convective transfer coefficient h. So here if you closely observe there exists a symmetry if you draw a horizontal line passing through the middle of this diagram. So you can place the origin of the coordinate system here on this point. This will be the x direction and this will be the y direction. So here total this width is 2l, so that is why each part width will become l. And this length of this geometry, let us say extends from x is equals to 0 on the left face to x is equals to infinity on the right face. So this problem is quite similar to the previous problem we considered. So here you first write the governing differential equation. So this is a case of simple two dimensional heat conduction. So the governing differential equation you can rewrite dou square T by dou x square plus dou square T by dou y square equals to 0. So if you see this governing differential equation is different than the governing differential equation we wrote for the previous problem, because previous problem it was a case of a fin for which there was heat transfer from the top and the bottom surface also, but we considered that the variation of temperature in the thickness direction is negligible, but here it is a two dimensional geometry only. So that is why this will become the governing differential equation. Then the boundary conditions here, you require two boundary conditions along the x direction and two boundary conditions along the y direction. So first we rewrite at x is equals to 0, t is function of y, then at x is equals to infinity, t is equals to t infinity. Then here for the purpose of analysis, we will consider only either the upper portion or the lower portion. Here I am considering the upper portion. So at x is equals to 0 along this line, mathematically it will be a symmetry. So mathematically you can rewrite dt by dy equals to 0. Then on the upper face it will be heat transfer by means of convection is equals to heat transfer by means of convection. So you get at y is equal to L here, minus k dt by dy equals to h into t minus t infinity. So here again you will see this equation is homogeneous and these are not homogeneous. So we will use again a transformation theta equals to t minus t infinity. This is not going to convert into dimensionless, only transformation is used. So now using this transformation you rewrite the 5 equations, that is the governing differential equation along with the 4 boundary conditions. Now t will be replaced by theta, so you come dou square theta by dou x square plus dou square theta by dou y square equals to 0. Then the 4 boundary conditions you can rewrite at x is equals to 0, you will get t is equal to function of y. So this theta becomes here function of y minus t infinity, that let us say we rewrite as capital F y, that this is another function. Then at x is equals to infinity theta becomes 0, then y is equal to 0 here d theta by dy is 0, then here at the upper surface that is at y is equals to L minus k d theta by dy equal to h into theta, because theta is nothing but t minus t infinity. So here if you closely observe, out of this 4 boundary condition, the last 3 boundary condition, that is boundary condition number 2, 3 and 4 are homogeneous in nature along with the governing differential equation. So you can apply the separation of variables and you solve the problem. So here I am not going to solve it, so please try to do it yourself so that you will be able to learn the concept of applying this concept of separation of variables. For your reference, I will just note down the final expression for the temperature profile theta, which is function of x and y, that you will get if you are able to solve this problem correctly with proper steps. So you will get the expression for temperature profile theta, that comes out to be sigma n equals to 1 to infinity, then you will get 2 lambda n e to the power minus lambda n x into cos lambda n y divided by lambda n l plus sin lambda n l into cos lambda n l multiplied by integration of capital F eta cos lambda n eta d eta with limit 0 to l. So where the value of lambda n should be known to you, here in this case you will not get an exclusive expression for lambda n, rather than you will get a form of this form lambda n l into 10 lambda n l equals to h by k, where n varies from 1 2, 3 like this. So from here you can find out an expression for lambda n that can be used here in this expression for temperature profile theta. So please try to solve it and compare your solution with this one. You should be able to get this form of the expression. Then let us say we will consider a special case. Suppose this function on this left face is given to be a some constant value, because in the earlier problem we considered this to be a constant because at the base of the fin it is constant, though this problem is not exactly the same because the governing differential equation is different. So if let us say this take this Fy equals to t naught, then you will get, you when you put this one here, this one t naught minus t infinity, this we wrote as capital Fy, so this capital Fy becomes t naught minus t infinity, which will be some constant value, and this constant value we can put it here in the function for f eta. So this becomes constant, that will come outside the integration, then what remains here, integration of cos lambda and eta into d eta with limit 0 to l. So this integration you can simplify, then you multiply with this expression, that will tell you the expression for the temperature profile theta, which is function of x and y. So what remains, this will remain as it is. Then when you integrate this one, this becomes t naught minus t infinity come outside, then integration of cos lambda and eta d eta with limit 0 to l will give you the value sin lambda n l by lambda n, okay. And theta is nothing but t minus t infinity, and here you are having t naught minus t infinity, that you can take to the other side. So, you will get on the left hand side t minus t infinity by t naught minus t infinity equals to this 2 is a constant that can be taken outside the sigma, and the remaining things will stay inside the sigma. So, this will be the expression for temperature T as a function of x and y. So, you see here you are having the variable x and here you are having the variable y. So, you take different value of x and y for the different points where you want the temperature, and you simplify this expression, that will tell you the temperature exactly at that location. Next, we will consider how you will handle boundary conditions which are not homogeneous in nature. So, let us say we will consider a two dimensional problem. Suppose you have a two dimensional domain which extends from x is equals to 0 to x is equals to a along the x direction, and extends from y is equals to 0 to y is equals to b in the y direction. That means, you have a rectangular area. Here temperature T is function of x and y having constant thermal conductivity k. Suppose on the left face the temperature condition is given that it is function of y, that means it is varying in the y direction, this function let it be f 1 y. Similarly, on the other face here again temperature is again function of y, but this is not the same function. So, the variation will be slightly different, so let it be f 2 y. Similarly, on the this bottom face temperature is function of x, so you write as f 3 x. Again at the top temperature is function of x again, that is we write as f 4 x, that means these 4 are the different functions. So, here if you closely observe, it is not possible to convert any one or all the boundary conditions into homogeneous form by considering any transformation as we did in the earlier problems. So, what you have to do is, if such problems arise, that means when the number of non-homogeneous boundary conditions is more than 1, because earlier we solved problems where out of 4 boundary conditions, 1 boundary condition was non-homogeneous, remaining 3 were homogeneous. But here in this case you will see all the 4 boundary conditions are non-homogeneous. So, in such case what you will do, when the number of non-homogeneous boundary conditions is more than 1, the problem need to be divided into a number of simple problems which you can solve using the concept already you know. That means, you divide this complicated problem into sum of problems where each problem can be solved using the concept of separation of variable. To solve a problem using the concept of separation of variable, at least 3 boundary conditions should be homogeneous. That means, you make this problem sum of more than 1 problem, so that in each problem you will have 3 number of homogeneous boundary conditions. So, how you will do this one? You will do this one using the principle of superposition, where you will superimpose the solution of the simple problems. So, what you can do is, let us say you consider the governing differential equation for this case. So, it is a simple two dimensional heat conduction. For this problem, the governing differential equation mathematically can be written as dou square T by dou x square plus dou square T by dou y square equals to 0. Then you rewrite the boundary conditions. So, at x is equals to 0, T is equal to f 1 y, at x is equals to a, T is equals to f 2 y, at y equals to 0, you get T equal to f 3 x, then at y is equal to b, T is equal to f 4 x. This is the original problem given to us. So, what you will do is, here all the 4 boundary conditions are not homogeneous, whereas this governing differential equation is linear and homogeneous. So, what you will do is, we will use the principle of superposition to solve this problem. So, first let us say you consider one problem where the geometry is exactly same as this one, that is the dimensions are a and b along the x and y direction respectively, and here this boundary condition on this face is exactly same as the boundary condition given in the original problem, but the boundary condition on the remaining 3 faces will be such that the temperature is constant, because we are going to superimpose this problem with similar more problem. So, this is the one problem we considered. Similarly, you consider another problem same dimension, here this time you take this boundary condition exactly same as the original one, and the for remaining 3 you take t equals to 0. Then you take the third case where you will take this condition, that is here it is exactly same as the original case and the remaining three boundaries temperature is 0. Then you consider the fourth case, that is temperature on the fourth boundary is function that is given in the original problem and the remaining three boundaries temperature are 0. Now what you have to do, you use the principle of superposition, that is you superimpose one problem over another, so that you see when you are going to add 0 with something it is not going to change. That is why you see, for example, it is t 0, it is again 0, 0, 3 times 0 plus f 4 x, that will make only f 4 x only here. So, like this, here it is f 1 y plus 0 plus 0 plus 0, that will make f 1 y only. That means, if you superimpose all the four problems, it will result to the original problem itself. So, here it, you see what is the important is here t 1 is function of x, here t 2 is function of, sorry, t 1 is function of x and y here, t 2 is function of x and y here, t 3 is function of x and y here, t 4 is function of x and y here. So, if you add them together, that will give you the expression for t, that is t function of x y is nothing but sum of t 1, t 2, t 3 and t 4 together. So, now you know how to solve this problem, already we solved. So, you solve this problem, that is individual problems using the earlier concept. Then once you get the solution for individual problem, that is t 1, t 2, t 3 and t 4, you add them together, that will give you the expression that is desired for the original problem, where temperature t will vary along the x and y direction within the limit of x is equals to 0 to a and y equals to 0 to b. So, please try to take some problems from textbooks and use this concept and try to solve them. So, next we will consider how you will handle a problem where the governing differential equation itself is not homogeneous in nature, because here what we consider in the previous slide, it was a case of homogeneous governing differential equation, but non-homogeneous boundary conditions. But if the governing differential equation itself is not homogeneous, how we will solve it? We will see now. Let us say you consider a two dimensional heat conduction problem. So, here the dimensions are 2a and 2b along the x and y direction. So, here temperature T is varying with x and y. We consider constant thermal conductivity, but this time we will consider there is an internal heat generation, because this internal heat generation term will only convert the governing differential equation into non-homogeneous. Then on the boundary, the conditions are, it is a constant temperature which is equal to some temperature that is T infinity. So, if you closely observe, there exists a symmetry about a horizontal line and about a vertical line that will pass through the center of this diagram. So, you consider any one of the four portions as the for the purpose of your analysis. Let us say we will consider this one as the for the purpose of our analysis. So, here you will have this boundary and this boundary are these two boundaries. So, where mathematically they are insulated, at the remaining two boundaries here and here it is constant temperature that is equals to T infinity. So, here if mathematically it becomes dou T by dou y 0, sorry dou T by dou x 0, and here mathematically it will be dou T by dou y equals to 0, and the dimensions will extend from 0 to a here and 0 to b here. So, we will consider this problem and try to solve it. So, if you rewrite the governing differential equation for this case, it is a case of two dimensional heat conduction with internal heat generation. So, for which the governing differential equation you can write as dou square T by dou x square plus dou square T by dou y square plus q triple prime by k equals to 0. So, this equation is not homogeneous, though this is linear. So, this is non-homogeneous because of the presence of this third term, that is q triple prime by k. So, now write the boundary conditions for this case. So, the first boundary conditions will be at x is equals to 0, that is dou T by dou x equals to 0. Sorry, this will become dou T by dou x is 0. Then here second boundary condition at x is equals to a, this is T equals to T infinity. Third boundary condition at y is equals to 0, it is dou T by dou y 0. Then fourth boundary condition at y is equals to b, t is equals to t infinity. So these are the four boundary conditions. So now here you will see boundary condition number 3, this is homogeneous. Boundary condition number 1 is also homogeneous, but boundary condition 2 and 4 are not homogeneous, including the governing differential equation. So now we will consider a transformation for the temperature by taking theta equals to T minus T infinity, and we rewrite the governing differential equation and the boundary conditions. So now this T will be replaced by theta. So the governing differential equation now will become dou square theta by dou x square plus dou square theta by dou y square plus q triple prime by k equals to 0 after using the transformation. But please remember, this transformation is not going to alter the nature of the equation. Still it is non-homogeneous but linear governing differential equation. Then we will rewrite the boundary conditions. So first becomes x equal to 0, dou theta by dou x 0, x is equals to a theta equals to 0. Then y is equals to 0, you will become dou theta by dou y 0, then y is equals to b, theta becomes 0. So now here you will see all the four boundary conditions are now homogeneous. So how we will solve this equation? Still the governing differential equation is non-homogeneous in nature. So what you have to do is here we will consider a solution for theta, which is function of x and y, as the sum of two different functions phi and psi, where the function phi is function of x and y and the function psi is function of x only. So this you can take as a function of y also, it does not matter. So later on you will see, you have to also do the same problem. So now using this theta equals to phi plus psi, please remember this phi is function of x and y and psi is function of x, that means you can take derivative of phi with respect to x and y, but you cannot take derivative of psi with respect to y, because derivative of psi with respect to y will become 0. So using this one, you rewrite the governing differential equation, that means you replace this theta by phi plus psi, then again you solve it. So first it is dou square theta by dou x square, that means derivative of theta with respect to x twice. So that means here both the terms are function of x, that means you have to take double derivative of phi as well as double derivative of psi, that is why you are getting dou square phi by dou x square plus dou square psi by dou x square. Then second term it says double derivative of theta with respect to y, so it is function of y, that is why for which it is not problem, you can take double derivative, that is why you will get dou square phi by dou y square. Then when you take double derivative of this expression with respect to y, this will become 0, so that is why you will not get anything. And what remains here is q triple prime by k, that is equals to 0. So this becomes your governing differential equation. So here you see this is function of x, this is function of x, this is function of y, and this is a constant. So what you can do is you can rewrite this expression as by separating phi and psi. So it is dou square phi by dou x square plus dou square phi by dou y square is there. So I have written them together. Then plus what remains here, dou square psi by dou x square, and this constant I combined with this term, plus q triple prime by k equals to 0. So the same expression I wrote it here. So now what we will do is this equation that we have written here, it can be written as superimposition of two simple problems. That means you take two simple problems, if you add them together, this will result to this problem equation. So here we will split this problem into two separate problems. So where one problem will become say 2D problem, another problem will become a 1D problem. So here this part I wrote it here and this part I wrote it here, that will be equals to 0, because if you add these together, that results to this problem. So here dou square phi by dou x square plus dou square phi by dou y square equal to 0, it results a two dimensional heat conduction problem. And this results to a one dimensional heat conduction with internal heat generation. And for these two problems, separately you need to write the boundary conditions, so that their sum will result to the boundary condition originally we written for the actual problem. So here you will see this is a ordinary differential equation, because it is a function of x only, instead of dou you can write down d also. Then this becomes a partial differential equation, because phi is function of both x and y. So here you require two boundary conditions and here you require four boundary conditions, two along the x direction, two along the y direction. So first you will write for this one, one will be at x is equals to 0, then second one will be at x is equals to a. So at x is equals to 0, it is dou theta by dou x 0. Now theta becomes here psi. So you write dou psi by dou x equals to 0. Then here theta is equals to 0. So this theta becomes now psi here. So psi equals to 0 here. Then for the second case, so before you go for the second case, here what you can do, you can simplify this problem. Find the expression for psi as a function of x with the help of these two boundary conditions. That I have not done here, so please try to do it. If you solve this governing differential equation with the help of these two boundary conditions properly, finally you should get the expression for psi as a function of x only, which comes out to be q triple prime a square by 2k whole into 1 minus x square by a square. Then we will consider this 2D problem. So here for at x is equals to 0, it is dou theta by dou x equals to 0. Here now theta is equals to phi. So it becomes dou phi by dou x equals to 0. Then at x is equals to a, theta is 0, theta is again phi. So you write phi equals to 0. Then at y is equals to 0, dou theta by dou y 0. Now theta becomes phi again. So dou phi by dou y 0. Then at y is equals to b, here you write theta is equals to 0. What is theta? Theta is nothing but phi plus psi. So phi plus psi is 0, that means phi equals to minus psi. So this is the important point here, you have to remember this one. Here theta is 0, so theta is nothing but psi plus phi. So phi equals to minus psi. So this is the important point here. So now you see, if you closely observe these four boundary conditions written here, the first three boundary conditions are homogeneous in nature, including the governing differential equation. This is not a homogeneous boundary condition, but still you know how to solve this problem. When you have three boundary conditions along with the governing differential equation is homogeneous in nature. So please try to solve it here. I am not going to elaborate the intermediate steps. So finally, if you solve this problem correctly, you will get the expression for phi, which is function of x and y, which comes out to be minus 2 q triple prime by k into sigma n is equals to 0 to infinity, then inside sigma you will get minus 1 to the power n cos lambda n x cos hyperbolic lambda n y divided by cos lambda n b, where the expression for lambda n comes out to be 2n plus 1 into pi by 2 a. So you use this lambda n inside this expression here, that will tell you the expression for phi. So already you got the expression for psi and phi. So this theta equal to psi plus phi. So you can use them together here, that will give you the expression for theta. So that I have written here again. This is the expression for phi and psi written separately. So now use this theta equals to psi plus phi. You add them together, that will give you the expression for theta, which is function of x and y. So here you can further simplify by taking the common terms, that is your q triple prime by k into a square. So you multiply this here a square and divide by a square. So at the bottom you will get a q, and you take the term common q triple prime by k into a square, that will come to this outside. So that again we have taken here to the bottom on the left hand side, so that I can rewrite this in the dimensionless form, and what remains, that will be the expression for the dimensionless temperature profile. So if you remember, we started with considering expression theta equals to phi plus psi, where phi is function of x, y and psi is function of x. You can solve the same problem, instead of considering psi as function of x, you can consider psi as function of y also. The steps will be exactly same, and you check whether you get the same expression or not. So please try to solve it yourself. Okay, we will continue in the next class.